Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jordana Mendelson, and I'm the director of the KJCC. Over the course of this year, we have launched many programs and initiatives, and so many of them mean a great deal to me and our team. However, today's event holds a special place for us since we are celebrating a new publication by Jo Labanyi, a treasured colleague and friend, who is also director of the KJCC from 2008 to 2014. A year ago, we had plans to celebrate Jo's Spanish Culture from Romanticism to the Present, Structures of Feeling, a book which you will learn more about over the next hour and a half. We had to cancel that event because of the COVID-19 pandemic. So we are grateful to be able to host this celebration today, which even though happening online instead of in person, we hope communicates the warmth and community with which we had hoped to accompany this event last year. It is April 1st, April Fool's Day. So we also hope we make a bit of trouble this afternoon. To help us with this, we bring together with Jo three incredible colleagues. Porter Fernandez, who comes from the CICIC in Madrid and who has worked with Jo on many projects. Sarah Thomas, who wrote her PhD under Jo's supervision and is now an associate professor at Brown University. And Alejandra Rosenberg Navarro, currently a graduate student in the Department of Spanish and Portuguese at NYU and one of Jo's advisees. This intergenerational conversation or troublemaking session manifests the impact that Jo's research and writing has made on so many scholars here in the US and abroad in the UK and Spain. Many of whom, I hope are joining us today. While I was never Jo's official student, I wish I had been, she has been a mentor to me for over 20 years. She served as a peer reviewer for my first book manuscript and sent me copious amounts of comments, which I hope made the book better, actually, but were quite intimidating at the time. She supported my case for tenure, and since I came to NYU over 13 years ago, has modeled for me the very best of scholarship, mentorship, and administrative leadership. Without Jo's incisive scholarship, and even more her impact as a person who is invested and engaged with not just what we write about, but who we are, our field would be much poorer, and each of us would have made our way through the academy with a lot less joy. Because it is joy that I think we all feel when reading one of Jo's essays, precisely because she asks us to flex our intellectual muscles in ways we didn't know we could. I am truly grateful to Jo and thrilled to host today's roundtable. Before we start, a few quick announcements. Following the presentations, we'll bring questions from the public. So please, if you're on Facebook, if you're logged in, to the right of the live stream, there is a comments box and you can put your comments or questions. We'll make sure that Jo gets to read them all later. So you can also just congratulate her and lots of smiley faces and big thumbs up, and we'll be happy to see those later. If you are not logged into Facebook, you can also send comments to our address at KJCC, which is kjc.info@nyu.edu, and we'll bring those questions forward. If you are interested in purchasing Jo's book, the publisher is offering a great 50% discount to attendees. So virtual, if you replay the event later, you can still look for the book at a discount, and that information is available on the chat as well as on the event flyer. The event will be in English and Spanish. Vamos a hacer un evento bilingüe, que es una novedad, so you can listen in Spanish and English. We're hoping there's some fluency between both languages. Finally, to learn more about each of our speakers, please go to the KJCC website and you'll see brief bios on each of us. Now, it gives me great pleasure to hand over the next part of the program to Jo.
Thank you so much, Jordana, for your lovely words, which I think illustrate to everybody what a superlative colleague you are. I mean, you really are the absolute number one, as far as I'm concerned. You're also number one event organizer, and I congratulate you for that. And I'd like to thank you hugely for persisting with organizing this event. As you said, this is not the first time we've tried to organize it. It's the third time. The advantage is, although we won't be able to see each other, that they are, I hope, going to be people logging on from elsewhere in the States and from Europe. We know that quite a lot of people have logged on already. So although I can't see you, I'm sure I can feel the vibes. I would like also to thank many other people. First, I think I should thank the managing editor of the publisher of the book, Legenda. That's the publishing branch of the British Modern Humanities Research Association, which is a bit like the kind of British MLA, except it doesn't organise conferences, but it has a really quite robust, in fact, I think more robust publishing branch than the MLA. Graham Nelson, the managing editor, was an absolute pleasure to work with. If any of you are looking for publishers for your next book, I really would recommend Legenda as a serious alternative. They also they brought out the book within 6 months of me sending them the text, which I think is an absolute record. So I would recommend them very strongly. The other people I need to thank, and I'm very pleased to thank, are Laura Turegano, the mastermind of everything at the King Juan Carlos Center, who keeps us all under control. Isabel, for organizing all the tech aspects of this event so well. And Estefania, for the beautifully designed flyer, which I really, really liked. And of course, a big thank you to the three panelists. Pura Fernandez, Sarah Thomas, Alejandra Rosenberg Navarro. I really like the fact that we have a panel which is not only all female, but represents different stages of an academic career. That was, of course, chosen deliberately, and I think that's, I couldn't have wished for anything nicer than that. So thank you so much for taking part. And of course, thank you to all the invisible people I can't see, but who we know are out there. What I wanted to do to start is say a little bit about what I wanted to do with the book, how it happened, kind of how I see it, which may or may not be the way that others see it. It was actually published in September 2019, so I had to refresh my memory myself as to what was in it. I was extremely happy to be invited to include this volume in the book series called Selected Essays of Legenda. It's a series that publishes, reprints rather, essays by scholars of a certain age, shall we say. I did say at the end of their career, and I crossed that out because I don't like being thinking that I'm at the end of anything. The idea of this series is that it brings together in one accessible place essays that have appeared in various venues and that are often hard to locate. It was particularly nice to feel I hadn't been forgotten in my own country, the UK, even though I left it 15 years ago to move very happily to the United States. I was also particularly happy to be just the second scholar of Spain to appear in the book series. The first, very well deserved, was Alison Sinclair, who is a very long-standing friend and who I assumed must have been the person who put my name forward, but actually I was wrong. So a thank you to whoever it was who suggested me, who may or may not be listening. I was allowed complete freedom in choosing up to 30 essays. In the end, I chose 24. I thought that was quite enough. And there were some interesting discoveries in the process of making that choice. First, I decided I hadn't written anything interesting in the first 20 years of my career. That may make some of you who are younger scholars feel better, or maybe it'll make you feel worse. I'm not quite sure. So the essays that I chose were published between 1995 and 2018. I should mention that I left out most of the essays that will appear in my eternally unfinished book on 1940s cinema that I will finish now I'm retired. It's not coincidence that I started with the mid-1990s, because that's when feminist studies took off in scholarship on Spanish culture, particularly in the English Language Academy. And it's important to remember that scholarship on 19th century Spanish literature led the field in that respect, with scholars like Lucian and Deutsch, Alison Sinclair, Alda Blanco, Susan Kirkpatrick, and others. That may come as a surprise to younger scholars, very few of whom work on the 19th century today, but in the 1990s, it really was the cutting edge. I wanted to choose a selection of essays that covered the range of my interests, and I also wanted to cover a range of historical periods from the early 19th century to the present day. The book is hardly a history of Spanish culture, but I hope it does give some idea of historical change, since history is important to me. For that reason, I put the essays in chronological order of the periods covered. In selecting the essays, I also discovered my own chronological evolution as a scholar, which was an interesting experience. What became clear was how history had become increasingly important to me. I prefer to say I work in cultural history rather than cultural studies. What also became clear, but I hadn't thought about it consciously before, was how that increasing concern with historicization was accompanied by a decreasing interest in psychoanalysis. I was actually quite surprised to be reminded of how much I'd used psychoanalysis earlier in my career. It was kind of what one did as a scholar working on gender in the 1990s. I'm not quite sure why psychoanalysis faded out of my work, but I know I learned a lot from it, particularly in the field of gender studies. Even if much feminist criticism of the time, the 1990s, was taken up with arguing with Freud. While gender's not at the forefront of all the essays in the volume, it is central to many of them. My main surprise in going over my earlier work was to discover that my present interest in the history of the emotions had been a constant pretty much from the start, that is, if one ignores what I wrote before 1995. But I wasn't aware of that at the time, and in many cases, the interest in the emotions is implicit rather than explicit. I guess that's partly because emotions are everywhere, even if they aren't explicitly acknowledged. But I also realised my huge debt to Raymond Williams, who was never mentioned in my student years at Oxford in the 1960s, but was everywhere in the cultural atmosphere in Britain at the time. What was imbibed in me as a student in Oxford bore no resemblance whatsoever to what was going on in the cultural atmosphere in Britain at the time, I may say. Raymond Williams was also certainly everywhere in British cultural studies, as is evident in the work of scholars like Stuart Hall at the now mythical Birmingham Centre for Contemporary Cultural Studies, disgracefully closed down in 2002. I wanted to title my book Structures of Feeling as a homage to Raymond Williams, but that title was taken, so it got shunted to the subtitle. I'm eternally grateful for that background in British cultural studies, which also taught me that culture is about power in many different ways, and for that reason is always political. What British cultural studies also taught me is that popular culture should not be dismissed as simplistic. On the contrary, the contradictions in popular culture make it an extraordinary barometer of the tensions of any period. And what I also learned from analysing popular culture, most evident in my work on the early Franco period, is much of it is huge fun. Thank you for mentioning that word joy, Jordana, because that is very important to me. My number one rule would be, if you don't get enjoyment out of what you're studying, don't do it. By fun, I don't necessarily mean funny, but that it should have energy and give you energy as a scholar. It's clear, I think, from the book that my great loves are the later 19th century and the early Franco period. And the energies I got and get from studying those periods came from different sources. In the case of the 19th century, the privilege of having a British Academy Leverhulme Fellowship allowed me 2 years of intensive archival research at the Bibliotheca Nacional. That was before I knew anybody who is here with us on the panel today. That immersion in the archive gave me my first experience of feeling I was getting under the skin of a period and appreciating what made it tick. In the case of the early Franco period, I was able to spend 6 months at Filmoteca Española. And if Marga Lobo is out there listening, many thanks to you, Marga, for all your wonderful suggestions during that time and since, and for having become a wonderful friend. Plunging into the early Franco period, made me realize that it's a terrible mistake to suppose that all cultural production under a brutal dictatorship, and it was brutal, is a reflection of regime ideology. That's still the assumption of much scholarship on the early Franco period, though things are fortunately changing. It's insulting to Spaniards who lived through the period to suppose that they were dupes of the regime. They were not. And I became very aware of that with the interviews for another of my eternally unfinished projects, the oral history of cinema going in 1940s and 1950s Spain. And if any of the other participants in that project have logged in, that's Katie Vernon, Steve Marsh, Eva Woods, Susan Martin Marquez. A big abrazo to you, and we really are going to finish that book this year. A key reason why the early Franco period grabs me as a scholar is my admiration for the resilience of Spaniards in dealing with so much hardship and repression. When studying cultural production of the early Franco period, I was constantly surprised by what I was finding, whether in cinema, which at the time was by definition popular culture, or in popular fiction. I was finding things that weren't supposed to be there, but they were there. If there's another constant in the essays I chose for this volume, it's a concern to read against the grain, and that's also where the enjoyment comes in. So, to end, if I'm supposed to throw out some kind of nugget of wisdom from the hindsight of 45 years in the profession, this is what it would be. Be open to finding in what you study things that you weren't expecting to find. Those surprises are always much more interesting than what you did expect to find. Thank you so much to everyone for being here.
Our first speaker is Pura Fernandez. Pura, we'll let you begin. No se oye. Prueba otra vez.
¿Se me oye?
Sí.
Sí, sí.
Sí, ¿no?
Sí.
Bueno, si no me haces una indicación. Muchísimas gracias. Bueno, yo voy a dar inicio a esa parte bilingüe que ha mencionado Jordana de esta sesión. Por supuesto, agradeciendo a Jordana, a Laura, a Isabel, toda su ayuda y sobre todo su invitación por poder estar aquí en este acto con Joe, por poder embutirme y zambullirme en ese libro que ha sido todo un reto y sobre todo el reto es hablar después de Joe e intentar ceñirme a lo que hemos pactado, que son unos minutos que voy a resumir en 5 folios que he escrito para no hacer ningún tipo de excurso. Así voy a empezar, ya que estamos en este entorno virtual en el que se realiza la presentación y que está muy en sintonía con el imperio de las digital humanities y las cartografías y los mapeados en que se traduce todo lo que cae en la esfera del big data, que en definitiva no han hecho más que reforzar la idea de que cualquier representación es una fórmula cultural marcada por el lenguaje de una época. En este insólito año de pandemia, que celebramos también el bicentenario de Baudelaire, que con su mirada de artista trazó otro mapa cotidiano, el del flâneur que deambula por la ciudad moderna y refleja la realidad cambiante y atomizada, el desorden de las cosas, que en el espacio público dialogan de otra manera, rompen las convenciones y exhiben una mecánica de relación que tiene su lógica propia. Es la lógica de lo que fluye, de lo que se mueve, de lo que se construye en el momento en que es aprendido por la mirada del ser en movimiento, que con su experiencia da forma y sentido a la vida y a sus ansiedades. Así, en un punto de estos mapas móviles que somos cada cual, en los que se van dibujando nuestros nudos afectivos, profesionales y personales, coincidí por primera vez con Jo Labanyi hace 12 años. Simbólicamente, el espacio y el momento en que nos cruzamos no podían ser más propicios. Una isla atlántica, Las Palmas, y el Congreso en torno al gran cronista de la modernidad, a Galdós. Cuando llegué a aquel encuentro galdosiano, estaba todavía bajo el influjo de un libro magnífico, Gender and Modernization in the Spanish Realist Novel, la brillante monografía con que Joe abordaba las principales obras de Galdós, de Valera, de Emilia Pardo Bazán. En el contexto de formación del proyecto de Nación Liberal, a través, en buena medida, y una parte constitutiva de esa España que eran las que podemos llamar las no ciudadanas. Las mujeres que no tenían estatuto político ni autonomía jurídica y social, pero cuyas vidas ilustraban esa transformación deformante de la realidad representada. El espejismo de una modernidad que parecía iluminarse de manera trabajosa e imperfecta a fogonazos literarios en un país que intentaba resurgir de las ruinas de un imperio en descomposición, con una sociedad convulsa y dividida, pero en la que alentaba también un espíritu reformista y modernizador. Jo articulaba una rica gama de lecturas teóricas en su análisis cultural y ponía en diálogo a la España decimonónica con los principales debates de la época sobre higiene, educación, moral, política, urbanismo, economía. Como una inquieta flanés, rebuscaba en las imágenes, en las palabras, en las metáforas, en los conceptos y en su traducción cultural. Y lo hacía bajo una autodefinición que la primera vez que la leí me dejó completamente asombrada. Trapera cultural. Cultural rag picker, siguiendo a David Tracy. Es decir, la que escarba, recolecta, exhuma detalles textuales e históricos heterogéneos y los reensambla a la luz de los diversos discursos públicos contemporáneos. Una metodología interdisciplinar que en este contexto cobraba todo su paradójico e irónico sentido. Esta fórmula aplicaba los 24 artículos del volumen Spanish Culture for Romanticism to the Present, Exchange of Feeling, que presentan con claridad ese periodo productivo que solo se asocia con los y las grandes maestros y maestras. Esto es, la vigencia de sus propuestas por encima de modas teóricas y la capacidad de prefigurar lo que termina por convertirse en tendencia en su ámbito disciplinar. Así como una inspiración para lo que más se necesita en un campo académico, esto es cuestionarse y repensarse. Este mosaico de 24 ensayos exhibe la dimensión de un nuevo atlas que, como nos enseñó el de Demosine de Warburg, puede hacer visibles conexiones y relaciones para hilar una nueva propuesta de historia cultural a través de la interpretación de piezas de teatro, de novelas, de cine, de fotografía, de música, fuentes orales, que son un barómetro para detectar el cambio cultural, sus síntomas y sus efectos. Desde el primer capítulo, Love, Politics and the Making of the Modern European Subject, Spanish Romanticism and the Arab World, emergen los principios teóricos que otorgan unidad e interrelacionan los restantes estudios del volumen. En este caso, a través de un vínculo con el proyecto de investigación europeo dirigido por la profesora Luisa Pasedini, Europe, Emotion, Identities, Politics, Europe and Love, un eje axial determinante en el libro. Este marco de análisis va creando los principios de una discusión explícita e implícita, de perspectiva diacrónica y sincrónica entre las diversas temáticas, géneros literarios y discursivos, formatos artísticos, obras y autores y autoras, a lo largo de un libro que arranca desde los años 30 del siglo XIX hasta la actualidad más inmediata. Así, en sus páginas transitamos desde el drama romántico y la novela y pintura realistas del siglo XIX hasta la modernidad ensayada en el cine y en la narrativa de los inicios del XX. Desde la ficción popular y la cinematografía del primer franquismo y las nuevas propuestas de las últimas décadas del siglo pasado hasta el debate actual en torno a la memoria histórica. Los criterios de ordenación de una materia tan amplia como heterogénea son esos indicadores del mapa de Nemosyne que dibujan un territorio poroso y en constante diálogo en torno a conceptos guía y a procesos como nación, historia, identidad, subjetividad, género, emociones o memoria. Fluyen, interaccionan, tensionan y se metamorfosean para aproximarnos con intensidad a esas estructuras de sentimiento que, como señala Raymond Williams, se corresponden y definen momentos históricos que determinan las manifestaciones culturales y demuestran la historicidad de las emociones. Como un circuito fluido, el capítulo primero, centrado en los orígenes de la construcción de la nación liberal en ese convulso 19, atravesado también por guerras fratricidas, por tensiones y consensos, enlaza con el último cierre, con el último de cierre sobre las fracturas y traumas de una nueva memoria histórica, la de la guerra civil, aún en proceso de negociación. Los dramas históricos de la década de los 30 ilustran la melancolía de la España imperial frente a una modernidad que requiere la ruptura con el pasado en nombre de un progreso que termina por ver la memoria histórica como una forma de tradicionalismo. Pero la melancolía romántica puede proveer un camino en su mirada al pasado, a la Edad Media y a esas fronteras de los reinos cristianos y musulmanes como una alternativa al presente a través de lo que Jo caracteriza como subjetividad fronteriza. Es decir, una noción del sujeto liberal moderno que todavía no está delimitado y en la que apunta de una manera tan rápida como prudente a la border theory de los Latin Studies, con esa estructura dialógica constante entre pasado y presente a que conduce la fenomenología cultural. Estos exponentes del romanticismo se diseccionan a la luz de una sofisticada propuesta teórica en torno a las relaciones entre los sexos, y la diferencia se erige en esos principios de la teoría liberal con las vinculaciones entre propiedad y capacidad jurídica, en torno a su naturaleza destructiva y al temor a la influencia de la feminidad en el proceso de formación de la identidad individual masculina. La lectura de la historia, esta vez contemporánea, se implica también de forma constituyente en el exitoso y prolífico proyecto literario del republicano Wenceslao Aiwaszewski y su nuevo género, la llamada historia novela, que discurre en paralelo al arranque del reinado isabelino. Su polimorfa empresa cultural, llena de bestsellers, se entrelaza con los episodios nacionales galdosianos y sus novelas contemporáneas, que en esta comparativa cobran dimensión nueva, como escuela de formación de ciudadanos, en una comunidad imaginada del proyecto realista a través de lo que llama el affective engagement. Una interpretación aplicable también a las pinturas históricas, como ese espléndido cuadro de Padilla que figura en la cubierta del libro, y su capacidad de creación de imaginarios y de intervención en el debate público, estimulado también por cierto tono gótico. Un tono que busca la empatía en la representación de un pasado que aspiraba a ser nacional. Es fascinante el contraste con la historia, nada grandilocuente, de la serenidad cotidiana de las fotografías de dos extranjeras durante la Guerra Civil, Margaret Michaelis y Kathy Horner. Como apunta Joe, si el interés por la contienda sigue despertando pasiones, es quizá porque sugiere de forma tangible la posibilidad de que la historia podría haber sido de otra manera, como evocan las imágenes citadas. Todo un emblema de la eternidad de las ruinas que entre los escombros contienen el potencial no realizado de vidas y de objetos olvidados. Los objetos, como portadores de afecto y de memoria, son una constante reflexiva en estas páginas de forma especial, sobre todo las novelas de Galdós, y algunas de sus pertenencias en el espacio personal de su Casa de las Palmas. En el escritor canario centra Joe una mirada multiplicada que transita desde la versión cinematográfica de Tristana de Buñuel, con todo su aparataje fetichista simbólico, y un sugestivo recorrido por la neutralización del valor de uso y de cambio de las mercancías en sus novelas, revestidas de su valor afectivo como objetos de uso cotidiano y de memoria en las relaciones interpersonales que los dotaron de sentido. La novela realista del 19 dedica páginas brillantes como las que analizan el cuestionamiento autorreflexivo de sus propios procedimientos de representación de la sociedad de su tiempo, como un anticipo de un proceso propio del modernismo de principios del 20, pero de una forma más compleja, como evidencia Joe, porque si el modernismo se entiende generalmente como la exploración de la brecha entre la realidad y la representación, la novela realista española detecta que esa realidad se ha convertido en representación, una problematización y cuestionamiento de la categoría de gran importancia ontológica. La precisión analítica aplicada a cada palabra escrita, bueno, Jordán ha mencionado su cualidad y su capacidad editora y correctora, y el sentido destilado de cada texto, hablan de la distinción y disolución de fronteras entre naturaleza y cultura, de la redefinición de las esferas públicas privadas en el seno familiar, en suma, de la realidad, la representación, el simulacro y la erosión de las normas, especialmente las de género, que interaccionan de forma constante con otro sistema fraudulento, el de la representación de la política. Nación, género, historia, memoria, subjetividad, emociones, modernidad, son partes interrelacionadas y omnipresentes en la ecuación de este nuevo libro, que es un libro nuevo, porque la selección y la narrativa que los emparenta ofrecen otra interpretación de conjunto. Esto se manifiesta en las lecturas de Fortunata y Jacinta y la desilusión galdosiana proyectada en una falsa memoria en torno a lo que pudo ser, un constructo que termina por superponerse al horizonte espacio-temporal de un futuro vacío. El mismo horizonte que se presenta ante Ana Ozores, un personaje definido por emociones negativas que se analizan como productoras de agencia, y el uso del discurso indirecto libre de la novela, en la que la confusión emocional de la protagonista la convierte en ilegible, incluso para ella misma, y que se explica agudamente en el marco teórico del giro afectivo. El propósito ambicioso, anunciado en el título, se cumple en toda su amplitud. El análisis cultural, a partir de un rico corpus de expresiones artísticas, que oscilan entre lo canónico y lo popular, entre lo tradicional y lo innovador, muestran el sistema de relaciones internas con sus conflictos, discontinuidades y retrocesos en ese lento y problemático camino hacia la modernidad, en un marco de discusión teórica que resulta extremadamente útil como propuesta interpretativa más allá de los estudios de caso expuestos, como sucede con el impacto que el lenguaje expresivo del cine tuvo en Buñuel, en Dalí, en García Lorca, Baruja Mayo o Jiménez Caballero. En torno a ellos gravitan temas como la ciudad, sus ambivalencias respecto a la alta cultura, la cultura de masas y las mujeres. El polifacético Jiménez Caballero y su imaginería sexual son un buen exponente del fascismo que opera como antídoto contra el miedo masculino a la aniquilación del yo. En lectura paralela y política al mito de Don Juan, superhombre fascista, con los modelos destilados por otros autores como Salvador de Madariaga y Ramiro de Maeztu. Son trabajos que a su vez interseccionan de manera brillante con los que abordan cuestiones tan actuales como el activismo feminista de las mujeres de ideología conservadora y fascista, a través de una polifonía de voces extraídas de novelas, diarios, discursos, autobiografías, en el entorno del pensamiento acerca de la diferencia sexual y su retórica de sumisión como una vía paradójica de empoderamiento femenino. Esta rayuela de lecturas cruzadas que reactivan y renuevan el contenido de los trabajos se repite en ensayos en torno a Concha Linares Becerra y Luisa María Linares, las hermanas que reinaron en el género de la llamada novela rosa. Sus numerosas ediciones y versiones cinematográficas son leídas en el contexto de las tácticas cotidianas ensayadas por los faltos de poder y de voz de que habla Michel de Certeau, lo que convierte sus libros en potenciales manuales de entrenamiento para sobrevivir en un entorno hostil. El mismo en que se enfoca los nuevos proyectos que está desarrollando Joe en estos momentos sobre la historia oral del cine en las décadas de los 40 y 50 y el estudio monográfico de las películas durante la dictadura. Y paso al folio 5. Los artículos, inspirados en la cultura de esta época, revelan que las opiniones predominantes, y lo ha comentado Joe también, sobre el carácter monolítico de la cultura y el cine del primer franquismo son una falacia simplificadora, como lo demuestra el de los años 40, atentamente analizado más allá de las películas habituales, incluso en ese género folclórico musical en el que brilló Estrellita Castro. Buena muestra de esta ruptura de lugares comunes es la mirada sobre la olvidada perspectiva colonial y su discurso durante el franquismo, que interacciona con los orígenes históricos y su representación en el imaginario nacional de la primera parte del libro, centrado también en las formas y fórmulas del amor, con sorprendentes resultados como el tratamiento de las relaciones homoeróticas y la visión positiva del mestizaje. En suma, esta colección de estudios es también un interesante ejercicio de lectura histórica acerca de los intereses y perspectivas de la práctica de un peninsularismo transatlántico enriquecido por los Cultural Studies, que desde el año 2000 y por impulso de la propia Joe, tiene su mascarón de proa en el Journal of Spanish Cultural Studies. En las páginas preliminares del libro hay un esbozo de radiografía del hispanismo peninsular en Reino Unido, en Estados Unidos y en España, de alguien que ha vivido de esas tradiciones académicas y que apela a un necesario intercambio y transfusión donde se conjugue la perspectiva interdisciplinar fundamentada en un armazón teórico en el que puedan dialogar los estudios filológicos, históricos y culturales. Como decía, y para terminar, hay una lógica teórica y conceptual que dirige de forma interna la construcción del nuevo libro de Joe. Al tiempo, implica un ejercicio reflexivo acerca del subtexto que mueve a la elección de los ámbitos de investigación, impulsados a menudo por una fuerza motriz interna que solo, con la mirada retrospectiva, adquiere su propio argumentario y coherencia. Las breves pero reveladoras palabras iniciales, un texto nuevo y casi diría programático, así lo diagnostican. En varios de los estudios de este volumen, como el que desentraña los fantasmas del pasado en la película El desencanto de Chávarri, yo planteo el desafío de cuestionar las premisas que adquieren estatuto hegemónico en ciertos momentos históricos o en ciertas disciplinas. Se trata, en definitiva, de un punto de vista que define la propia actividad como estudiante, como profesora, como académica, como editora, como esa trapera cultural que desde los márgenes y a menudo en las fronteras disciplinares recolecta preguntas esenciales que sobrevuelan lo obvio y apelan a la raíz de las imágenes, de los textos y de los contextos, excavando y drenando sus posibles significados desde la temporalidad, siempre condicionada también de nuestro presente, para configurar una arqueología interpretativa de la España contemporánea. Todo esto lo ofrece el libro, que trasluce la lucidez de quien vive la inquietud constante del movimiento entre continentes, entre países y culturas, entre disciplinas y formatos, entre lenguas. Como dice el título de un delicioso librito de otra insigne profesora de NYU, Silvia Molloy, un estar entre que dota a Joe de esa capacidad de análisis, de interlocución brillante y siempre generosa, desde la otredad que impregna a quien se interna en otros mundos y en sus representaciones. Muchísimas gracias.
Muchísimas gracias, Pura. Vamos a pasar ahora a Sara. Y Sara, le doy la palabra ahora.
Muchas gracias. Bueno, en el espíritu del bilingüismo voy a cambiar de idioma de nuevo. I wrote my remarks in English, so I'll change. First of all, I'd just like to thank everyone, Jordana and the KJCC for the incredible organization of this event, Laura, Isabel, Luis, everyone who's behind the scenes, Alejandra and Pura for their comments, and with whom it's really an honor to share space today. And of course, Joe, for writing the incredible work contained in this book, for bringing us together on this very happy occasion, even if not together in the same place, and also for her generosity, support, and enthusiasm always. So it is a true pleasure to be here today with so many dear friends and esteemed colleagues at my former institutional home to celebrate this extraordinary book, which is a testament to Jo's remarkable career thus far. The volume structure, with 24 wide-ranging essays arranged chronologically in order of the topics they treat, makes the reader feel as though they're being given an intimate masterclass on modern and contemporary Spain, led by the hand from the 19th century to the present. I must admit that this reading experience gave me a deep sense of nostalgia for the courses I took with Jo during my graduate career, and I learned an incredible amount both then and now. In my remarks today, I'd like to just touch on several of the running themes and approaches I've observed in reading this book, exploring Jo's diverse and dynamic work across decades of writing in a much more concentrated and systematic fashion than I ever had before. While I've always been aware of the many ways that Jo is exemplary as a scholar and as a teacher, boundlessly generous with her time and energy, incisive and pathbreaking in her scholarship, reading this book gave me new insight into just what a privilege it was and is to be trained by Jo, both as her student and as her reader. And in this sense, I think we're all Jo's students. In my comments, I'll reflect briefly on how the writing collected in this book serves as a model for generous, thorough, responsible scholarship, bringing new materials to light and reading familiar ones in unfamiliar ways, building and sustaining a vibrant discipline that Jo was instrumental in configuring. So there are three parts. Part one, generosity. One of the immediately striking aspects of Jo's work is its generosity with those who have come before, both in terms of the subjects she studies and her engagement with other critical work. In reading the texts collected in the volume, I came away with a real sense of the profession as a community, one which Jo has worked for decades in building for Spanish cultural studies. We see this in the way that these texts seek to identify gaps or oversights, not to berate those who have overlooked them, but rather to build a more robust discipline and attend to what gets left out. The 2004 essay, which opens the volume on Spanish Romanticism in the Arab world, begins with a reflection of this nature, which I think merits quoting at length. Quote, "This particular piece of research was triggered by an increasing sense that something needs to be done about the black hole in Spanish studies, that is, the 18th century and the first half of the 19th century, which are now barely taught. Academic specialization has led to a lack of dialogue, not only between those working in different disciplines, but also between those working in the same department on different periods. One does early modern or modern culture with no joined up thinking about the moment of transition. We cannot do away with the division of history into periods, for historical specificity is hugely important, but perhaps we could institute a kind of historical border studies that tries to think across the historical divides produced by established schemes of periodization." There I end the quote. This is just one example among many of how the authorial voice that emerges from these pages is not a solitary, egoic I who seeks to impose mastery over the material studied, but rather is positioned as part of a collective, participating in an academic community and showing investment in the field and its betterment. Likewise, the way that Jo engages with other scholars is profoundly generative and respectful, building on her interlocutors' ideas and taking them in new directions without negating their validity or trampling them. In this sense, I see her work in a frame parallel to what Gary Wilder describes in the very different context of his work on decolonization in 20th century France as reading generously. He writes that, quote, to read generously is not to suspend critical evaluation, but sometimes to extend the logic of previous writers' propositions far beyond where they may have stopped, end of quote. This is a common thread in Jo's work, evidenced, for example, in her building on Russell Sebald's writing on Spanish realism in her third chapter, Being There, the documentary Impulse from Iguaz de Isco to Gaddos, or in her carrying forward David Harvey's concept of time-space compression in capitalism, itself adapted by John May and Nigel Thrift, in her piece on time-space compression and memory in Galdós's Fortunata y Jacinta, chapter 5 in this volume. This second instance is one of many where Jo is careful to unravel the genealogies of thought she brings into her writing, tracing these intellectual footsteps in detail, not only to buttress her own argument, but also to provide clear access to a theoretical framework that the reader might pick up for her own thinking. Other examples of this kind of deft intellectual mapping are the treatment of Raymond Williams and Antonio Gramsci in chapter 17, Musical Battles, Populism and Hegemony in the early Francoist Film Musical, or Avery Gordon and Jacques Derrida in chapter 22, History and Hauntology, or What Does One Do with the Ghosts of the Past, Reflections on Spanish Film and Fiction of the Post-Franco Period, among many others. As a small but not minor point, throughout the volume, the footnotes of the essays also evince a critical practice founded in gratitude and acknowledgement, with thanks throughout to colleagues and collaborators for suggesting particular theoretical axes or critical readings, as well as retrospective additions made to older pieces, acknowledging scholarship that has emerged since their original publication. Two, reading against the grain. This has already come up and is something Alejandra will detail further in her presentation in a beautiful reading of chapter 13, so I'll be brief. But as the book's own jacket copy and introduction emphasize, one of the most notable threads in thinking across the book is the practice of reading against the grain, defined in the introduction as, quote, looking beneath the textual surface for tensions that trouble its overt meaning, but remaining wary of the potential risks of, quote, becoming seduced by the pleasure of prizing out contrary meanings, or falling into the trap of supposing that all meanings that go against the grain are by definition subversive of dominant ideology, end of quote. If readings such as these are now logical or unsurprising in our field, it is undoubtedly in no small part thanks to Jo's meticulous work over several decades in carrying out this type of scholarship. This book is full of texts that question received ideas or elitist assumptions, challenge monolithic conceptions, and look beyond the seemingly obvious initial meanings of cultural artifacts and social realities. This is perhaps most evident in chapters on fascism and early Francoism, such as the brilliant work on cross-gender identification and Spanish female fascist activists to be discussed by Alejandra, or the essay on gender and history and cinema of the early Franco period, which demonstrate far more nuance, uncertainty, and fluidity in gender roles than we might expect based on a surface level reading of Francoist ideology. I also think it's important to mention that this reading against the grain is not just a key facet of Jo's own analyses throughout her career, but vitally a capacity with which she endows the historical subjects at the center of her research. In her readings of cinema under Francoism, for example, or in what is one of my favorite chapters among many in the book, chapter 5, Horror, Spectacle, and Nation Formation, Historical Painting in Late 19th Century Spain. Here, she shows another kind of generosity, in this case to the historical spectators of waxworks and paintings, not assuming that consumers of culture in the past or of lower social classes were necessarily uncritical readers ready to be manipulated by the images they consumed. Rather, while acknowledging that we cannot know exactly how spectators might have understood or reacted to these images, she suggests that viewers might have simultaneously enjoyed the sensationalism of gory waxwork figures while also reflecting on the mechanics of the illusion created. Or, in the case of Pradilla's transfixing painting, Doña Juana la Loca, which gives the book its stunning cover image, the artwork might have given spectators a multiplicity of possible identifications and interpretations. Here again, I think the text bears quoting at length. Jo writes, I suggest that the strength of Pradilla's painting is that, while binding spectators emotionally to its central figure, Juana, it forces them to try out a range of possible interpretations of the emotion they see dramatized in her figure, and which they internalize without being able to articulate its contours. The painting thus provides a schooling in the need to think twice before claiming to understand the motivations of other people, that is, in responsible social relations. It is also a schooling in the need to reflect before coming to hasty conclusions about one's reading of the national past. end of quote. This excerpt is exemplary of many moments in Jo's scholarship where she endows readers, viewers, and other cultural agents and consumers with a complex, nuanced interpretative capacity, distant as they may be from contemporary critics in time, space, or circumstance. Ever attentive to the fundamental differences between the historical past and the present moment from which it is theorized, Jo allows these figures too to read against the grain. And my final point three, imagined communities and the past and the present. This brings me to my final points about how Jo's work engages with two fundamental concerns at the heart of her scholarship. The construction of otherness, both in imagined communities structured around an axis of we who belong and they who do not, and in the relationship of the present to the past. In reading and rereading so much of this work produced along a trajectory of more than two decades, I was struck by how consistent these concerns are in analyzing a wide variety of historical contexts and cultural forms. An incredible diversity of objects of study that I had a long list of, but I cut because my thing's already too long, but it's incredible. So throughout the book, Jo's work thoughtfully parses and problematizes the capacity of both ideology and criticism to construct a certain privileged we, as well as an implicit corollary they, whether these map onto temporality, we in the present, they in the past, or categories of citizenship and belonging. More precisely, who gets to be interpolated as part of the nation, a political actor, or a subject in the first place. With characteristic attention to historical and cultural specificity, her work troubles these categories and shows how the construction of who is included or excluded is often, if not always, overdetermined and governed by ulterior motives. In many cases, these analyses require facing difficult or reprehensible material, as is the case of chapter 10, Women, Asian Hordes, and the Threat to the Self in Jiménez Caballero's Genio de España, one of many essays that does not shy away from difficult topics. Seeking to understand the workings of fascist Ernesto Jiménez Caballero's ideology and its deployment of shocking metaphors of sexual and gender-based violence in a nationalist and racializing frame. Although Jiménez Caballero's idiosyncratic conceptualizations of the Oriental in his 1932 text are shown to be indiscriminate at best and not necessarily always even linked to Asia, thinking about this essay in the wake of the Atlanta shootings and in a broader context of ascendant fascism and white supremacist violence in the United States, Spain, and beyond, I was chilled by how relevant its analysis was for this very different historical moment, where, despite important differences in circumstance, an ideology of elimination of the supposed other via misogynist violence rings all too relevant and familiar. It should perhaps not be surprising then that the past feels relevant for the present in this way, given that an insistence on how both the past and the idea of the past shape the present is a hallmark of Jo's work across topics and periods. In another of my favorite essays, The Politics of the Everyday and the Eternity of Ruins, Two Women Photographers in Republican Spain, material I first encountered in a course with Jo 15 years ago, she brilliantly reads the photographs of Margaret Michaelis and Katy Horna alongside Walter Benjamin, persuasively showing how these images, like ruins, reveal both the impermanence and the materiality of history, bringing into the present the immediacy of the past as, quote, a now that stands outside of time and yet forms the matter of history, end of quote. Throughout the book, complex relations back and forth across time are foregrounded, most obviously perhaps in the texts on historical memory of the Civil War or Francoism, but also in instances like thinking about the role of confession in 19th century novels as, quote, one of the main tools for producing a modern sense of individual subjectivity, given that it requires a review of one's past, end of quote, or in the chapter on history paintings, where the theatrical tableau, quote, produces a disconcerting freezing of time, which disturbs any providentialist notion of history moving inexorably towards a present, thereby constructed as the realization of a manifest destiny, end quote. Returning for a moment to the figure of Juana, Jo shows us, quote, the status of the past as living dead, gone, but still with us in its effects, end quote. An emblematic framing that echoes across contexts to her chapter on history and ontology in the Spanish Civil War, among others. These crisscrossings across the incredible diversity of periods, texts, and objects studied in the book are evidence of Jo Labanyi's sustained, deep, creative, and path-breaking thinking about key questions for Spanish cultural studies. There are only a few of the many strands I might have mentioned, among others, that are equally important, like Jo's deft handling of an impressive range of topics while remaining ever attentive to the specificities of both textual form and cultural historical context, the importance of affect and emotion across her scholarly output, her insistent critical attention to the slippages between what is considered high and low culture and why, or the fundamental emphasis on gender throughout the book, with its focus on women as both producers and consumers of culture, as well as the representation of gender in literal and metaphorical terms. I will close just by expressing my sincere and profound gratitude to Jo for her generosity and her inspirational work, which is a true pleasure to read, beautifully written and capturing on paper the spark of joy that so many of us know from seeing her face light up when she engages enthusiastically with an idea. It is work that inspires me and so many of us to keep reading and thinking generously against the grain as part of the scholarly community she has indelibly marked. Thank you, Jo.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thanks so much, Sarah. Our last panelist is Alejandra Rosenberg Navarro, and after that, we'll turn the floor back over to Jo briefly. And so I would like to remind everyone listening, and there are a lot of you, that don't be shy about putting your questions in the chat so that when we open to public, we can bring those out for the panel. So I'd like to pass, pass the Zoom, pass the microphone over to Alejandra Rosenberg Navarro.
Thank you, Jordana. Voy a hablar en castellano para el espíritu bilingüe de este evento. Gracias, Jordana, Laura, Laia, Estefanía, Luis, todos los del KJCC, por la organización de esta presentación del maravilloso libro de Jo Labanyi. Es un grandísimo honor para mí estar compartiendo esta mesa virtual con vosotras, Sara, Pura, Jo, Jordana, y tengo muchísimas ganas de, después de mi intervención, de que podamos hablar con también los que estáis escuchando sobre este maravilloso libro. Spanish Culture, From the Romanticism to the Present, Structures of Feeling, es una contribución fundamental para nuestro campo y para las lectoras en cualquier momento de su carrera, desde aquellas más avanzadas en sus trayectorias a aquellas que, como yo y otras compañeras estudiantes, estamos comenzando y estamos empezando a adentrarnos en el campo. A través de sus capítulos, el libro abarca una visión muy amplia de la cultura española, amplia en términos temporales. Empezamos por el romanticismo y el realismo del siglo XVIII, pasamos por la cultura decimonónica, el siglo XX e incluso siglo XXI, pero también en términos materiales. Labanyi nos lleva por literatura, por cine, fotografía, cultura material e incluso por historia oral. La vastedad de los intereses de Labanyi no sacrifican en absoluto la especificidad de cada capítulo. Más bien, cada capítulo consigue centrarse en objetos culturales específicos y contextualizarlos en su momento histórico. Así, en el libro, la autora crea una visión completa, pero también específica, de la producción cultural desde el siglo XVIII hasta el siglo XXI. Podemos seguir los capítulos cronológicamente, tal y como están dispuestos en el libro, o podemos escoger nuestro propio camino, por el libro. En la introducción, justamente, y como también ha explicado, Labanyi sugiere diferentes maneras de aproximarnos a la obra. Así que, como si se tratara de Rayuela, podemos encontrar diferentes veredas por los artículos. Mi preferida es seguir el camino intelectual de la propia Labanyi, en ese orden, que comienza en el capítulo 6 y después acaba en el 6, no, perdón, comienza en el 2 y acaba en el 6, seguimos no solo las inclinaciones y tendencias de nuestro campo, sino también la propia evolución de los intereses de investigación y de la propia metodología de Labanyi. Pese a las fluctuaciones en sus intereses y marcos teóricos, a través de los más de 20 años que fueron publicados estos artículos, la metodología propia de Labanyi es constante en toda su obra. Su reading against the grain, su lectura a contrapelo, caracteriza cada uno de estos artículos. Tal y como Sara ha comentado, y justamente es lo que yo hoy quería como centrarme, enfocarme en esto. Así que lo que voy a hablar es no solo sobre la lectura contrapelo que hace Labanyi en el libro y en toda su escritura académica, sino también en su labor educativa. Aquellas que hemos tenido la suerte de ser sus estudiantes, hemos presenciado cómo Labanyi en el aula consigue dar la vuelta a los materiales para poderlos ver y analizar desde otra perspectiva. Cómo ofrece sus propias lecturas a contrapelo y nos invita a que hagamos las nuestras, sea cual sea el curso, el tema, los materiales. Tal y como nos recuerda Labanyi en la introducción a su libro, La lectura contrapelo revela los nudos dentro del texto que nos indican de alguna manera tensiones ideológicas de la sociedad en la que el texto opera. Además, sus lecturas a contrapelo nunca son en vacuo. Como ya he mencionado, Labanyi constantemente hila entre la obra y su contexto histórico-social, entre el contexto y la obra, creando una malla, una trama que ilumina y complica nuestras suposiciones y nuestros conocimientos. El viaje con Labanyi, tanto en el aula como a través de la lectura, es siempre uno de redescubrimiento y recuestionamiento. En su introducción, Labanyi indica uno de los peligros a las lecturas a contrapelo, que también ha mencionado Sarah, creer que todo lo que hace ruido y que puede llevar a nuevas lecturas sobre los materiales sea necesariamente subversivo a la lógica dominante. Labanyi se revela consciente de la trampa y no cae en ella, más bien al contrario, continuamente complica y teje más hilos entre los objetos culturales y su contexto para hacer más evidente la escala de grises entre esta ideología dominante y lo contracultural. Leyendo a Labanyi, nos damos cuenta de que creíamos que cierta cosa significaba algo, pero después, a través de la lectura contrapelo, esta cosa, este tema, estos materiales, se revelan como algo mucho más complejos y difíciles de encapsular bajo un único significante ideológico. A continuación, lo que voy a hacer es centrarme en el decimotercer capítulo del libro, Resemanticizing Feminine Surrender, Cross-Gender Identification in the Writing of Spanish Female Fascist Activists, para mostrar cómo Labanyi se acerca al texto. Según el artículo, pero le pido a la autora Jo, ya que está aquí, que me corrijas si me equivoco, la investigación surge de la necesidad de entender la complejidad en las representaciones que las mujeres fascistas hicieron de su propio género. En vez de asumir el rol y las motivaciones de las mujeres fascistas, Labanyi se interesa por su gesto creativo y por cómo y por qué algunas mujeres se hicieron activistas fascistas. Aunque algunas opinen que es problemático acercarnos al discurso de activistas falangistas, Labanyi ve una oportunidad para trabajar y estudiar aquellas áreas que han quedado ocultas en nuestra historiografía. Tal y como escribe Labanyi, abro cita, I consider it important to try to understand the mindset of those whose values one deplores. Cierro cita. Así como demuestra la autora, si prestamos atención a cómo se piensa y cómo se forma el género en las producciones culturales de mujeres fascistas, encontramos un nudo que complica la normatividad que asociamos a la ideología de género falangista. Labanyi parte de la noción de que la retórica falangista de la sumisión podía ofrecer a algunas mujeres activistas una posición de poder, ya que los valores de sumisión y de servicio no eran solo aplicados a las mujeres en el hogar, sino también a los hombres en la esfera pública y en el ámbito militar, estas categorías se vuelven un tanto resbaladizas. Slippage es la palabra que usa la autora. Y llegan a tambalear construcciones de género normativas. Para comenzar su lectura a contrapelo del discurso fascista en relación al género femenino, Labanyi encuentra un discurso de José Antonio Primo de Rivera del año 35 y encuentra una parte que casi nunca se cita y que dice así, abro cita. Ved, mujeres, cómo hemos hecho virtud capital de una virtud, la abnegación, que es sobre todo vuestra. Ojalá lleguemos en ella a tanta altura, ojalá lleguemos a ser en esto tan femeninos que algún día podáis de veras considerarnos hombres. Cierro cita. Esta cita es maravillosa. Es decir, Labanyi rescata una parte clave del discurso de José Antonio Primo de Rivera, en el que este dice que como para considerarse hombre, estos tienen que asimilar lo que en su entendimiento es ser femenino. Asimismo, no solo es la virtud de la abnegación, explica Labanyi, sino también la de la entrega, que han sido resemantizadas para llevarlas al ámbito de lo masculino. En su artículo, no solo Labanyi rescata una parte no citada del discurso de José Antonio Primo de Rivera, sino que parte de lo que ella detecta como cross-gendered identification para pensar psicoanalíticamente en la perversión y en la introyección en la figura de en la retórica de figuras falangistas como Pilar Primo de Rivera, Carmen Werner y Mercedes Sanz Bachiller. a través de su lectura del discurso de estas activistas falangistas y de las propias exhibiciones corporales dentro de las actividades de la sección femenina, Labanyi entiende cómo la búsqueda de una independencia y sentido de la propia identidad les lleva a usar la extrema sumisión para obtener una agencia dentro de la esfera pública en el que el yo tanto se niega como se confirma. El artículo de Labanyi no acaba aquí, sino que, y para mí aquí está la genialidad de Joe, emplea este marco establecido por los discursos orales y visuales públicos para leer las novelas de Carmen de Icaza y de Mercedes Formica, ambas escritoras y activistas falangistas. Así, Labanyi lee las novelas a través de la noción del uso de la sumisión como manera de garantizar agencia y poder. Y también las lee a través del cross-gender identification, como ahora voy a explicar. Me voy a centrar brevemente en las lecturas de Labanyi de la obra de Icaza. En Soñar la vida, Labanyi explica cómo él, la protagonista Teresa, escribe novelas bajo el seudónimo Juan Iraeta y acabará por sentir que su cuerpo femenino esconde su verdadera identidad masculina. Esta identidad de género secreta solo saldrá a la luz cuando Teresa barra Juan encuentra a su par romántico en un personaje masculino, Alfonso barra Lee, que está en silla de ruedas y que no supone una amenaza fálica. Y Teresa Juan le dice a su pareja, Juan Iraeta soy yo. En palabras de Labanyi, abro cita, it is her avowal of her masculine persona that clinches her fairytale romance with her fascinated with her fascist, if mutilated, prince. Cierro cita. El habitar diferentes géneros también lo encuentra Labanyi en Quién sabe, en que el protagonista, José María Castell, un joven espía falangista, es en realidad Teresa, una joven que ha tomado la identidad de su hermano fallecido, pero que ya en la persona de José María también se viste de mujer, esta vez de una viuda argentina, para llevar a cabo sus misiones secretas. Labanyi explica la dificultad de distinguir entre todas las personas que el cuerpo habita y cómo el narrador se refiere al protagonista tanto usando el femenino como el masculino, dando a entender que él o la protagonista habita varios géneros. Obviamente el capítulo de Labanyi aún adentra mucho más en la lectura de las obras y también en la obra de Formica. Pero quería con este ejemplo mostrar la metodología contrapelo de Labanyi y cómo ésta está siempre conectando su lectura súper cercana al texto con los discursos políticos y públicos que circulaban sobre el tema en cuestión. Ese vaivén que Joe hace tan maravillosamente. Aquí, a través de su análisis del contexto y de la obra de estas escritoras, Labanyi nos muestra cómo las mujeres activistas fascistas podían llegar a entender lo femenino y las calidades que se le adhieren, entrega, sumisión, etc., como una manera de llegar a tener una agencia y un poder otorgado exclusivamente a los hombres. La lectura a contrapelo de Joe, como este artículo ejemplifica, pero como caracteriza a todos los demás, complica nuestro entender sobre concepciones de género en un determinado contexto y nos muestra cómo incluso aquellos que creíamos que era lo más normativo, en realidad resulta mucho más complejo. En la introducción al volumen, Labanyi explica cómo la lectura contrapelo surge del momento en que el texto tiene algo que hace ruido, o que en palabras de Labanyi, makes trouble, cosa que vemos perfectamente en este capítulo que os he puesto como ejemplo. Pero a partir de la idea de Labanyi de la lectura contrapelo que makes trouble, me gustaría pensar en la propia figura de Jo Labanyi en el aula como también una troublemaker. Palabra que, como yo sé que ella sabe, digo cargada del sentido feminista o el significado feminista que le da Sarah Ahmed, alguien que desafía los conceptos preestablecidos y que además nos desvía a lectoras y alumnas del camino lineal y normativo del pensar. Digo troublemaker en inglés porque no encuentro un equivalente en castellano, aunque creo que la rebeldía de Julieta Kirkwood también sería muy apropiada aquí. Como profesora troublemaker o que piensa con rebeldía, Labanyi nos ha mostrado muchísimas alumnas otros caminos múltiples, otras maneras de pensar tanto sobre obras canónicas españolas como sobre temas y periodos históricos que ya traen a priori una serie de suposiciones. La rebeldía o el troublemaking de Jo Labanyi es contagioso y es, como ya se ha mencionado aquí, generoso. Está continuamente abriéndonos las puertas a aquellas que venimos detrás de ella y dándonos confianza para que nosotras también podamos llegar a nuestras propias lecturas a contrapelo, a nuestras interpretaciones rebeldes, cosa que vemos perfectamente en los maravillosos trabajos de las estudiantes que han trabajado o que trabajan con Labanyi. Un ejemplo es Sara, que está aquí, al lado, a mi lado, en la mesa. O otros ejemplos son mis queridas compañeras, la doctora Alejandra Vela y Cristín Martínez. En su tesis doctoral, Cursis Feministas, la doctora Vela reclama discursos que se habían insertado en la prensa mexicana con un mensaje que después sería llamado feminista, pero que han sido tradicionalmente y despectivamente catalogados como cursis. Martínez, en su tesis, hace una ecocrítica sobre fotografía, trabajo periodístico, documentales y literaturas del boom y postboom en la boom y del postboom de la construcción en España. Como estos ejemplos demuestran, y los de muchísimos más que hemos tenido el placer de trabajar con Jo, Labanyi no solo nos abre el camino, sino que cuida y cultiva estos caminos para que otras podamos continuar con la labor de pensar a contrapelo aquello que se nos ha enseñado, para que podamos continuar replanteando y pensando productos culturales against the grain. Por último, y para acabar, una anécdota. La primera vez que me reuní con Jo en su oficina, estaba obviamente súper nerviosa y cortada, lo estoy hoy también. La había leído y sentía mucho respeto y aún lo siento por ella. Entré en su oficina y me encontré con una fotografía de milicianas republicanas. Las miré y me dieron ánimos y una especie de calor de hogar, un caliu, como decimos en catalán. Jo, yo siento que nos das esas armas, esa actitud, esa confianza para encarar el camino que nos ayudas a hacer. No sabes el enorme privilegio que ha sido para todas nosotras tenerte como profesora, guía, mentora, amiga. Muchísimas gracias por todo en nombre personal y en nombre de tus alumnos.
Wonderful, how lovely. Thank you, Pura, Sarah, and Alejandra. As is perfectly, wonderfully appropriate, Jo is going to first kind of give some remarks, response to the three presentations. And then we are collecting your comments and questions. I think right now in the queue, we have about three. So after Jo's reflections, we'll move to read out some of those questions that you've posted. And if you haven't posted a question yet, I would encourage you to do so. We tend to have a rush the last 3 minutes. So if you've got an itching question, you should put it now so that we make sure to get it on the queue. Thank you so much, Jo. I'm gonna give it over to you.
Thank you so much to all three of you. I'm incredibly touched. And this probably sounds a sort of silly thing to say, but I think between you, you've produced a description of someone I would like to be. I'm not sure that I am that person, but I'll do my best. And I can, even if I'm not sure I am that person, I think I will assume that personality, at least provisionally, because it's convenient for me. Starting because it's fresh in my mind with things that you said about troublemaking, Alejandra. I'm so happy you brought in Sara Ahmed because I actually hadn't read Sara Ahmed and she hadn't yet started writing her books. When I wrote that particular essay, which is one of my favorites, the one that you picked up about the cross-gender identifications in these, well, in José Antonio and female fascist writers, which I think is one of my favorite essays of the ones I've written, because it's a perfect example of finding what shouldn't be there. I mean, these fascist women should not be writing these things, but they are, and it does flip everything upside down, and all your certainties kind of disappear, the ground under you starts wobbling, and you think, oops, I've got to rethink a lot of my assumptions. What makes me very grateful to you for having chosen that article is that the trying to understand the mindset of those whose values we deplore is something which I think is not yet happening in Spain. There is still such polarization. The reason that I moved away from memory studies to emotion studies was I started getting incredibly depressed by the fact that all the discourses on historical memory, which I thought really were going to start producing dialogue between people who do not hold the same political views, either now or in the past. All it did was produce more polarization than was there before, or perhaps just brought out into the open polarization that had become a little bit submerged during the transition. But that's my sort of number one kind of hope for how things may start going in Spain, that people will try to understand those they don't agree with, not agree with them, but try and see where they're coming from as a measure of respect for the fact that not everybody does hold the same views. I don't mean relativism, that all views are pretty much the same or interchangeable. They're not. But those views are there for particular reasons and circumstances that need to be understood. So thank you so much for picking that up. Going to Pura. Pura, you're one of the people who knows more about the 19th century than anybody I've ever encountered. So I particularly appreciate your words, and I've learned a huge amount from all your writing, meticulous writing about the 19th century. I loved what you said, because it's very flattering to me, about the cultural rag picker of Benjamin and Warburg's Atlas. That was especially nice. Kind of image to pick up. I was also interested in something you picked up, which I hadn't really thought about being that important in my work, but if it is, then I'd be very pleased. And that's an interest in history, not just as what happened, but looking at the possibilities which could have happened at a certain moment but got closed down for various reasons. And since I wrote most of what's in this book, got much more interested in the early 19th century as a period where I think a lot of the ideas that have become solidified by the time of the Restoration from 1875 onwards weren't ideas that one could necessarily see as being natural developments from the period of the 1830s, maybe by the 1840s, when starting to see the ideas being closed down. But I am very interested in those moments when all sorts of radical possibilities start emerging that didn't translate into reality, and trying to understand the reasons why that didn't happen. And of course, the transition to democracy in Spain is another example, as Germán Labrador has shown so well in the work he's done on the radical options of the transition that got closed down by almost everybody except the radical left. As the transition progressed. I hadn't actually realized, and you're right, Pura, that the beginning and the end of the book tie up, because the fractures of civil war are there, both with the Romantic period, with the War of Independence, which was a civil war in many respects, but also the Carlist Wars, with the Carlists almost taking Madrid in, I think it's 1834, which we tend to forget. I kind of hadn't really thought that I open the book with that, and then I end with historical memory and trying to come to terms with the suffering caused by the Francoist repression in and after the Spanish Civil War. So that must have been my unconscious making me take a good decision, but thank you very much for bringing that to my attention. Sara, I'd like to thank you for your generosity in your lovely, lovely that not sure if testimony is quite the right word, but I am very, very happy you picked up the idea of enjoying creating a community of scholars, because I think what is most wonderful about this profession is the networks it allows you to create, and that's why something like the Journal of Spanish Cultural Studies means so much to me, because again, it reflects very different kinds of work by people who may not have much in common, but they all have the same kind of passion for talking about culture in new and unexpected ways. And if they don't talk about culture in new and unexpected ways, I'm afraid we don't choose their essays. So that again is a great privilege. Of course, it's the peer reviewers who choose the essays, not me as the past editor, and Jordana, who now has taken on the torch. And thank you so much for doing that, Jordana. But it is wonderful seeing all the creative original work that scholars are doing, particularly younger scholars. We're always very happy if we publish work by students, grad students who haven't yet embarked on their first academic position, or who are still very new to the academy. And that, you know, that is something that I think is really, really important. I'd also like to thank you, Sarah, for saying something which was also very important to me. You talked about my face lighting up with ideas, and I think I've said this to just about every grad student I have, that for me the most useful thing I can do as an advisor is just let people talk and prod them to talk and talk until the moment their face lights up, and then that's going to be your thesis. And if your face never lights up, you're not there yet. You shouldn't be doing anything that doesn't make your face light up. So I think intuitive things like that, which are about being receptive to others, really are the key to what's going to produce good work. And I'm incredibly proud of the fact that none of my former grad students have ended up doing the kind of work that I do, that you've all done your own thing. And that's something that's very important to me. And if you do have something in common, I think it is what Alejandra identified, that you're all troublemakers. So we'll have a toast to troublemakers. Female troublemakers especially.
I love it.
Thank you to all of you. And now we'll pass back to Jordana, who is going to pick up the torch as moderator.
We have a lot of questions. Many of them revolve around kind of field question on Spanish cultural studies. So I'm going to begin by reading them out. Right now I have like four or five. So maybe we'll do a quick kind of, what do they call it, round robin. So maybe we'll kind of throw out a question, do some quick reflections, and see if we can't get to everyone's questions before we close our session. The first question, and I'll apologize in advance if I'm mispronouncing anybody's names. The first question is from Heidi Backus, and she writes, as a specialist in Spanish Gothic fiction, I'm truly grateful to Professor Labanyi for repeatedly calling out Spanish Academy's reluctance or even refusal to accept popular forms of literature and culture as serious subjects of study. Do you have any sense that this general mindset is changing now? And if not, what can we as scholars do to try and improve it?
You'd like me to come back now, or you want to come out with several questions?
Oh, I will read out all of the questions then. Okay. If that makes sense, I'll do that. And that way everyone will have heard their question read out. And that way you or the other panelists can pick and choose. That's a great suggestion. Professor Troublemaker, thank you. That's a great suggestion. Lee Mercer, who is a dear friend of ours, writes, Joe, I'm curious, when you reflect on the shift between your writing in the first 20 years of your career, not included in this anthology, to that of more recent years, do you think of yourself as having moved increasingly toward a, quote, reparative reading, a la Eve Sedgwick, of Spanish cultural studies? That's Lee's question. Rob Mayak writes, and lots of praises and congratulations are embedded in these questions as well. Rob writes, I want to reiterate my gratitude, Joe. Being your student has been a highlight of my doctoral studies. I am wondering about the arch of study that has developed since your groundbreaking volume edited with Helen Graham. You indicated potential areas for future research. Would it be possible to help us see gaps or areas of potential research that you continue to see? Then I have another question from Julia. Congratulations, your work has revolutionized modern and contemporary Iberian studies. What is your advice for junior scholars like myself? What do you hope for the future of the field? And then I have a question from Sarah Nadal as well. And I will, excuse me, I have to put my glasses on for this. She sent it to me by my phone. So let me see if I can read this. Here's Sarah's question. And that's probably all the ones that we'll throw out on the game board. So Sarah writes, it seems to me that in Joe's work, the shaping of subjectivity through form becomes another name for the act of reading. We are somehow privy to the effects of reading in the mind as two modes of production and social processes that encounter one another and are materialized in language as a living thing. To my mind, this is one of the most wonderful things Jo models in her writing. It is a joy to read Jo's reading. I think that's more of a comment, but I think Sarah's talking about that effective kind of joined readership, right? So those are the questions that we have so far. And I think you can, some of them you might even be able to answer a little bit together. Some of them have to do with the future of Spanish cultural studies. Where are the gaps in it? Where would you go from now? So I'll let you synthesize and answer as you like. And I think to Sarah, Alejandra, and Pura, if after Jo answers, you'd like to add anything, that would be really lovely as well.
Okay, thank you. There's some great questions there. Spanish Gothic fiction, that's great. And when we finish with me, that's something I think Pura will have some interesting things to talk about, because your wonderful essay in the Engaging the Emotions book on Zaragoza's Galleria Funibre, for me, is one of the best essays I've ever read. Yes, I think things are changing in the Spanish Academy with regard to an interest in popular culture. The problem I see is the incredibly rigid structure of the Spanish university system, both for getting a tenured position in the first place. So many people have to go through years and years of applying for scholarships that last for anything from 1 to 3 years before they actually get a position, which is going to last them for hopefully the rest of their careers. I think it makes people very wary of choosing a topic that might not be appreciated by the kind of official tribunals that count points in order to decide whether you get a promotion or you get a kind of permanent position or not. I've never understood how that point system works, except I know some wonderful scholars who have not got catedras, who was in absolutely scandalous ways, and it all came down to points. It would be interesting to know if there are any points for popular culture. Maybe the points don't divide according to the type of material that you work on. So I suppose one thing is it's very important for people who've made it in the Spanish academic system, where they're safe. They can't be thrown out anymore. To be able to be much freer in what they work on, and you're a model in that respect, Pura, the way you've branched out into, well, also your, the sort of really shocking naturalist novels you've worked on, and nobody can touch you. So it's wonderful that you've dealt with these really disreputable texts. But the question of what you do as a younger scholar wanting to work on popular culture, I think you do have to be careful if you're making your career in Spain. If you're not making your career in Spain, you probably are going to find your work is much more appreciated. What would make that work appreciated, certainly in this country, and it will be true in Britain as well, is that you are clearly conversant with the appropriate kind of theoretical work at the highest level, and that you're able to ask big questions of your material. So you're not just describing what's in your material, but you're showing why it matters. And that's actually another thing which I think, well, anyone who's been my student will know that, is there's always this question when I ask, why does it matter? Or Ike, when you've just sent me a chapter, et cetera, et cetera. I don't have a recipe for how to beat the Spanish system. I wish I did. Because there are wonderful people in the Spanish system, but the Spanish system is very, very rigid. And again, that's something that Pura working in it may or may not have some insights about. Okay, to pass on to your question, Lee. That's actually a very interesting one, the idea that I've moved towards a kind of reparative reading of the Spanish culture. The question is, what will be I be trying to seek reparation for? And I think one thing I've tried to do is seek reparation for what I think was the terrible education I got at Oxford in the mid-1960s. And I hope I'm not offending anyone who's listening. I doubt if anyone who I knew then would still be interested in my work. But I got brought up on the text and nothing but the text, and you weren't allowed to talk about anything outside the text. It's boring. So you do these meticulous analyses of the plot. People were still writing essays on whether characters were morally good or bad in Galdós. I mean, really. That's what I moved away from. In other words, I suppose I started asking big questions. And it was feminist criticism in the 1890s that allowed me to see that if you can't connect your objects of study with important issues in the real world, why are you doing it? So reparative in trying to get away from the education that I had at Oxford. And as I said, I somehow imbibed Raymond Williams, but he was never once mentioned, was never on any reading list I had as a student at Oxford, which, you know, in retrospect is actually really, really shocking. So I'm not sure that I'm trying to repair anything apart from my own education, which I think was not a helpful education. And I kind of started doing more interesting things despite the education I had, I think, probably. Though it did give me a training in close reading, and I have to say I'm very grateful for that training in close reading. I think it's important not to let go of that, as well as asking the big questions. But I'll have to think more about reparative of what, and we could have a sort of conversation another time about that, because I'm intrigued by that question. Rob, thank you very much for your question. Yes, that cultural studies book, I kind of remember when it was published, except I had great fun with Helen Graham putting it together, because we lived just a couple of streets away. It was when we were still working by phones, no email. So we were literally meeting on street corners, passing over papers in, you know, brown bags on street corners and going back home with them. And I remember doing the index with me in the village in Spain where I have a house, having to dictate my version of the index while holding the papers away from the wind. It was one hand, keeping the other hand free to keep feeding coins into the only phone there was in the village at the time in the central square. And somehow we did it. But it's a book which is good because we got some very good contributors. And I couldn't have done it without Helen as a historian who had a different network from me. And she found some absolutely wonderful people. I think it's not a book of cultural studies. It's a book intended to make cultural studies possible by putting together work by very different scholars in different fields that students could then pick their way through and make the connections themselves. I'm sure there are a huge amount of gaps. I mean, popular culture is still something that is not treated as much as I think it should be, or at least is not given, popular audiences are not given the credit they should be given. I think that's really the point I want to make. And I mean, one anecdote about that, which comes from the oral history of cinema going in early Francoist Spain, which was a turning point. I mean, those of my colleagues for that project who may be listening will probably remember that when we had a kind of project meeting. It was 2002 when I held the King Juan Carlos chair, and I can visualize exactly the little studio that I was sub-renting and us all being around the table, etc. There was a sort of epiphany because we had decided that we're all experts in culture. You know, we've read cultural theory. We know what we're looking for. And some of us were starting to get upset that the interviewees weren't talking about the things we wanted them to talk about. And the epiphany was suddenly, well, they're the experts on going to the cinema at the time, not us. And we need to respect what they wanted to talk about and what they saw as important. And it doesn't mean that our questions were wrong. It just means we were using different vocabularies. But it also made me realize that the people we interviewed, who were people in their 70s and 80s at the time, they didn't need cultural theory. They didn't need Michel de Certeau. They didn't need Bourdieu. They understood how culture worked in their own experience of it, absolutely perfectly, corroborating everything that de Certeau and Bourdieu say. And that for me was a real moment of humility, that popular audiences know what they're doing. And it's not that we're the experts and we come and tell them what they were doing without them realizing they're doing it. They knew what they were doing. They understood how cultural relations work, the power games that are involved in it, absolutely perfectly. Julia, that's Julia Chang, I imagine, is it? Thank you for your question. Is advice for the future of the field? I kind of think that's out of my hands because there's so many wonderful young male scholars. You're doing it, and you're one of them. So, I mean, the only advice I have is what I've said already. Keep looking for what's not supposed to be there. Keep working on what makes you light up. And yes, I mean, using the words that Alejandra picked up, be troublemakers. You know, don't be complacent about any received ideas. Try flipping things. It does, sometimes things shouldn't be flipped, but usually one can ask questions that prize out something that wasn't there before. And I know it is one of my annoying habits as an advisor, but I think it's a useful one for just when you think you've understood something, I come in and say, well, isn't it more complicated than that? And sort of always ask that question. Well, are you sure you've got to the bottom of it? Isn't there more complication that you can prize out here? So I would just congratulate the wonderful young scholars who are doing fantastic work, and you are the future. You don't need me to do that. Okay, Sarah, your question about sharing, shaping of subjectivity through the act of reading. That is something that Pura, again, is an expert on, because Pura has thought a lot about what reading means and the question of emotional communities. I think the interesting thing about that question, well, yes, I agree completely. The question of what is subjectivity is a tricky one. I mean, I've never believed there's such a thing as the self. I think they're just relationships, and that's what builds a sense of subjectivity through relationship, not as something that's inside you. So yes, your relationship with the books you're reading, the films you're seeing, is very much part of shaping that subjectivity through relationship. But I suppose the thing there is it's a matter of how you choose what you read and what you watch, as well as having a kind of always interrogating what you read and what you watch. So it's not a matter of you simply imbibe, absorb the values of what you're reading or watching, but just that what you read and watch gets the cogwheels working in your head and makes you start asking questions. Which may not be questions about what you're reading or viewing. There may be questions about something totally different, but trying to sort of connect the questions that emerge from what you're reading and viewing with the questions that emerge from real world experience. I don't know if that helps. And I don't know if Pura would like to come back on the question of reading and the shaping of subjectivity or Gothic novel.
Sí, se oye. Bueno, yo creo que ya con ese mapa que has trazado tú y las líneas en las que has apuntado, está prácticamente todo definido. Yo quería comentar algo que quité del texto, que era un poco largo, y es como se están hablando sobre todo en las preguntas sobre hacia dónde vamos, sobre el futuro, sobre lo que en general nos inquieta prácticamente a todas y a todos en la academia, ¿no? Y es hacia dónde vamos, hacia dónde confluimos. Yo comentaba la capacidad que tienen de semillero intelectual algunos trabajos, como por ejemplo tu artículo del año 2010, que sabes que para mí es como un altar, el de Doing Things, en el que te hace pensar y te hace reflexionar eso como un marco sobre una cantidad de problemas y de temas que has abordado durante años y que no has sido capaz de ver esos hilos internos que los comunica, ¿no? Y tiene que ver lógicamente con el proyecto que hicimos del volumen de Engaging Emotions, que ha tenido, y que eso sí que me lo vas a perdonar, Joe, y que yo eché en falta en tu notas preliminares de este libro, en el que hablas precisamente de esa necesidad del trabajo colaborativo, del trabajo interrelacionado y de las visiones de allá y de acá, porque indudablemente es el español, el castellano es una lengua imperial, obviamente como todas las grandes lenguas que están ahora mismo en el mundo, pero por lo mismo es una lengua transcontinental, es una lengua transatlántica, es una lengua de cruce de encuentros y de miradas, ¿no? Y eso que nació precisamente de tu generosidad y de tu incentivo intelectual, el proyecto de emociones con Elena, fue posible precisamente por lo que creo que es el futuro de la profesión, que es el intercambio entre gente de otras disciplinas, la capacidad de trabajo colaborativo y creo que también en parte el salir un poco del ensimismamiento a que nos lleva la academia. Y que a mí es una de las cosas que más me preocupa últimamente. Y quizá por mi trabajo como editora ahora, viendo lo que son los números. Es decir, tenemos una idea más o menos general de lo que escribimos y a quiénes nos dirigimos y quiénes están al otro lado, nuestros lectores. Ya no hablo de las comunidades imaginarias ni de comunidades emocionales, sino realmente de quiénes escribimos y para quién y quiénes nos leen, ¿no? Y a mí eso ya es una inquietud, digamos, personal, ¿no? Lo que quizá más me angustia últimamente es este mundo tan endogámico en el que nos movemos y en el que apenas hay retorno. Quizá precisamente con estas generaciones jóvenes y con este futuro maravilloso que hemos tenido con Sara y con Alejandra y con los comentarios que se hace, tengamos posibilidad de ver cómo trascender eso. Pero los números de los libros, los lectores, a mí me hacen pensar que estamos muy ensimismados en lo que hacemos, muy ensimismados en lo que hacemos y que nos falta quizá también pensar cómo llegar a otra parte de la sociedad y cómo contribuir, ¿no? Entonces, las recetas mágicas que no existen, pero yo creo que una de ellas es crear esas comunidades. Yo creo que tú además tienes esa capacidad y lo has demostrado y se ha reconocido aquí, de crear esas comunidades de estudiantes, comunidades de colegas que bebemos de ti, que bebemos de tu generosidad, de ese estímulo y que nos ponemos en contacto. Yo creo que es lo fundamental de estos mapas del hispanismo, es entrar en contacto y romper estas fronteras enormes que existen entre el peninsularismo, y hablo de un peninsularismo por no hablar de un hispanismo que tiene que ser mucho más abierto, mucho más general, en el que nos conectemos porque tenemos intereses comunes y porque además necesitamos oxigenarnos y sobrevivir, ¿no? Y ese es el futuro. Y desde luego, y tú lo comentabas lo comentas en tu libro, quizá esa falta de diálogo o de expectativas que hay con el peninsularismo peninsular, con el que se hace en España, ¿no? Y quizá mi visión es un poco, está un poco desenfocada porque yo trabajo en el Consejo Superior de Investigaciones Científicas, donde la máxima es el trabajo interdisciplinar entre personas especializadas en ámbitos muy diversos y en el que precisamente los que provenimos de las humanidades somos la rareza, somos la excepción. Pero también es cierto que, y me gustaría preguntar a Alejandra de qué universidad viene, porque ahora mismo no me acuerdo, que ya hay grupos de investigación, y por eso decía lo del trabajo colaborativo, hay grupos en las universidades que saben precisamente de esa necesidad de los lenguajes comunicados, de utilizar otros productos culturales para intentar explicarnos ahora y explicar el pasado, ¿no? Que hay, por supuesto, en Barcelona, hay en Madrid, hay en Cádiz, hay en Valencia, y que, bueno, son pequeños puntos a veces en el mapa, pero precisamente estos grupos que estamos generando y estas dinámicas de trabajo comunicadas nos pueden hacer poner a la gente en contacto, que es lo que necesitamos, ¿no? Porque los libros, y el tuyo es el ejemplo, yo de verdad he disfrutado tantísimo leyéndolo, ha sido un reto enorme porque incluso los trabajos que ya conocía y que había leído, decía Alejandra contrapelo, es que les he dado otra vuelta de lectura, ¿no? Esa productividad intelectual que me parece tan inmensamente rica y a la vez como un reto constante precisamente a lo que yo ya tengo escrito o tengo pensado, creo que es lo que tenemos que difundir también, ¿no? Es lo que tenemos que comunicar. Y ahora quizá lo bueno de la pandemia es que hemos visto que podemos tener puntos de encuentro virtuales muy productivos y mucho más rápidos y fluidos, ¿no? O sea, que es quizá la parte positiva que tenemos para repensarnos y para esta gente maravillosa que viene, además, eso con tanta fuerza. Pero yo creo que hay un cierto ensimismamiento, lo siento, o sea, es mi opinión, exclusivamente personal, hay un cierto ensimismamiento en la academia.
Perdona, Pura. Vamos a cerrar con una última pregunta que no vi al principio al leer la lista. Y creo que voy a leer esta pregunta y luego dejamos a que contestemos y luego cerraremos la sección para los que estén escuchando. Entonces, esta pregunta viene de Nuria Godón y escribe: me ha interesado muchísimo la puerta abierta que Jo deja a la interpretación cuando decide poner signos de interrogación al valor negativo del masoquismo. Me pregunto si ese signo de interrogación se dirige directamente a negar la pasividad a la que se ha asociado al masoquismo, especialmente al vinculado al género femenino. De ser así, como sospecho, cuestionar el valor negativo del masoquismo no significa tampoco que sea positivo. Entonces, ¿qué otro objetivo se le podría otorgar a este valor? Y Nuria nos va a ayudar a cerrar la sección, ¿no? Esta pregunta tan llamativa.
Okay, thank you. Female masochism is an interesting way to end this all-female session. You know, that's an idea that I got from Lou Shannon Deutsch in her book on mid-19th century women writers, where she has a chapter on literature by women in the mid-19th century, where she suggests that maybe that kind of wallowing in suffering and feeling a victim is a kind of training for dealing with the difficulties of life. And that's exactly the point that Pura makes in her wonderful essay on Zaragoza's Galleria Funibre in our Engaging the Emotions volume. Which, yes, was an exhilarating experience, the three of us working on that together, especially writing the prologue together with me in Australia, you in Spain, Elena Delgado in the States. That was great fun, and I think it produced something that none of us could have done on our own. But, I mean, your essay, Pura, is just absolutely fascinating. These Gothic tales, which are addressed explicitly to women, and you propose, with pretty good textual evidence, that they are conceived by the author as a way of training women in dealing with the horrors of history. In other words, the more you sensitize women to horror, the more you get them able to handle it. And I'm not sure if I'm representing you well, but I just thought that was such a wonderful reading of those really, really, really Gothic tales. So I'm not sure if I quite answered you, Nuria. So I'm not sure that it's just about questioning masochism as being passive. And of course, Deleuze has already done that. I think it's more, actually, I think it's Tanya Modleski also talks about Gothic fiction for women as an unpopular Gothic fiction as being a way of training women in handling the horrors of life, and particularly the horrors of many of their marriages. I think it's more about that training people to deal with horror. I find interesting because that takes the horror outside of the text into not just the home, though that's obviously important for female readers who don't have divorce, but into the horror of history as well. But I got it completely from reading Lou Shannon Deutsch, and I have acknowledged her every time I've talked about that. It was her brilliant idea. Again, it was Lou just flipping it and making masochism something productive for women.
That's wonderful. I've loved this conversation so much, not only for the way in which it works across generations, but also as a kind of a masterclass. I've really enjoyed these questions and answers, and I hope that everyone watching has as well, because if you haven't been in a seminar with Jo, you just got a little micro experience of what it's like to, you know, work collaboratively, listen to dialogue. And I do also want to emphasize kind of Jo's encouragement that there are different ways of working and working collaboratively. And my sense is that one has to think in contrast to the increasing professionalization and competition, which is part of the academic job market. That's a reality, but I think also these productive synergies that have been on display here, that you're all making in your own minds as you listen to these wonderful scholars, you know, is something that I think can be imprinted, right? And Joe, you have been the model for that, not only in your modeling of it intellectually, but I think as we've all reiterated, that intellectuals are people. And it also is that networking of people and people who respect each other and support each other and create communities where productivity doesn't mean success or failure, but experimentation. So I wanted to just thank you on behalf of, there are nearly 100 people listening. So I'm going to thank you on behalf of the many, many people who are listening.
All of you.
to thank also, you know, Sarah, Alejandra, and Pura for assisting us, to our wonderful tech maven, Isabel, who made everything run so flawlessly. And I'm going to let Joe close out our session.
What can I say, except I've found this hugely enjoyable. I agree completely with what you said, Pura, about how working together is the way to break molds, because if you put several people, this is why seminars are such a wonderful pedagogical exercise, because you end up with ideas that no individual person in the room could have had without you all working together to question, pull out more complexity as the seminar progresses. But I think I'd really like to end looking towards the future to say that I am not just hopeful, I'm totally in awe of the wonderful work that young scholars are doing. And I think that's why when I said that the fact that I decided my first 20 years of writing really didn't produce anything interesting that might make you actually feel depressed rather than encouraged. I would hate any of you to conclude from that what you're writing now you won't value in 20 years, because I think the quality of what people are doing today bears no resemblance to the quality of what was being done when I started my career in the 1970s. So I'd like to end looking forward to the work of the future, and I can't wait to read more of it.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Bye, everybody.